A very good evening to one and all present in the GIBS Talks Season 1 on the theme Roadmap to Higher Education Post-COVID-19. Today, on behalf of Geeta Ratan International Business School, Rohini, I, Kavya Buddhiraja, extend a warm welcome to you all to the first episode of GIBS Talks Season 1. Vakratunde Mahakai, Suryakoti Samaprabha, Nirvignam Kurumei Dev, Sarvakaryeshu Sarvada, which means, O Lord Ganesha, my humble prostrations to you, who is an embodiment of all wishes. Remembering you, I begin my studies, so that your grace and blessings shall bring success always. It is always auspicious to begin every event by glorifying Lord Ganesha. So let us all invoke Lord Ganesha by singing his Vandana together. Geeta Ratan International Business School was established in the year 2004. Gibbs is affiliated to Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University, Delhi, and is approved by All India Council for Technical Education, Ministry of HRD, Government of India for Technical Programs, and Bar Council of India for Law Programs. The institute is accredited as Category A by NAC in its second cycle and as Category A plus by State Fee Regulatory Committee. Also, it has been rated the highest grading A by Joint Inspection Committee of Government of NCT of Delhi and Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University, Delhi. Gibbs has been rated Grade A by Academic Audit Cell of Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University consecutively from past 7 years. It has also been rated number 2 twice by Times B School Survey. The institute conducts various programs under the head of MBA, MBA International Business, MCA Integrated, BBA, BBA LLB Integrated, and BA LLB Integrated. Now, let me inform you all about the very objective of this talk show. The theme of Gibbs Talks Season 1 is Roadmap to Higher Education Post-COVID-19. During this pandemic lockdown, different stakeholders of the education sector have faced multiple problems, and their problems still continue. The Ministry of HRD, Government of India, in the meantime, has set up their plan, and the University Grant Commission has already shared their guidelines to the universities and other higher educational institutions to prepare and disseminate their future plan towards closing of the ensuing academic semester. Due to extension of lockdown successively, many of the universities are waiting for the time being to circulate their action plan. And hence, the students, teachers, administrative staff members, and parents all are in dilemma with regards to the coming future. And so, to unfurl answers of all these questions roaming around in the minds of all the stakeholders, this talk show will bring to you different academic stalwarts of the country on every Sunday at 6 p.m. The resource person will deliver his speech on any sub-theme related to this main theme and will also answer a few questions raised by the attendees at the time of their respective registrations. COVID-19 has caused unprecedented disruptions for academics. India's lockdown measures have strictly led to a complete shutting of all kinds of academic activities. The shutdown was sudden and abrupt in several aspects. But many universities have endeavored to minimize the COVID-induced disruptions in order to facilitate academic activities without compromising the safety of students. The pandemic challenge has been accepted, Universities have become more responsive and proactive within the limited resources at their disposal. The abrupt shutdown gave a limited window to the institutions to prepare for the impending disruptions. Universities are now fast adapting to alternative pedagogy to engage students remotely and to continue the teaching and learning process in a teach-from-home situation. Now, this can be termed as pandemic pedagogy in academic lexicon. In the meantime, UGC has declared its future policies to face the challenges of the future days and declared an outline for the universities to prepare for the current academic year completion and the beginning of the coming academic session. Government of India has declared its Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan to boost the economy from a different perspective. Reforming governance for ease of doing business, recent corporate law measures, and technology-driven systems like that of online education during COVID are all part of this 20 lakh crore economic booster declared by the Honorable Finance Minister. However, all these policies are not properly deliberated before the academic stakeholders in large. Students, as well as the teaching fraternity, all are eager to know as to what will be their future, how future days pedagogy and academic delivery system will be so as to make the countrymen Atmanirbhar. This webinar has set up that very platform before the different stakeholders to learn from the authorities on multifarious important dimensions. It is indeed my honor to welcome and introduce you all to our today's legend, Professor Dr. K.K., Chairman, National Board of Accreditation, New Delhi. He will discuss the topic, Required Changes in Technical Education. Professor K.K. Agarwal has been associated with National Board of Accreditation in various capacities since its inception and was Chairman, EEAC Tier 2, before taking over as Chairman, National Board of Accreditation on January 14, 2019. Professor Agarwal obtained his Bachelor of Engineering degree from Punjab University and Master's degree from NIT Kurukshetra. Later, he did his PhD also from NIT Kurukshetra. After a distinguished service of 27 years at NIT Kurukshetra, Professor Agarwal served as Pro Vice Chancellor, Guru Jambeshwar University, Hisar, for a period of 3 years. And then, as founder Vice Chancellor of Guru Gobind Singh Prastha University, Delhi, for a period of 10 years. He has been President of Institution of Electronics and Telecommunication Engineers for the period from 2002 to 2004. President, Computer Society of India from 2007 to 2009. And President of Southeast Asia Regional Computer Confederation from 2008 to 2010. Sir, has published up to 400 papers in reputed journals, about 50% of these in international journals. He has been widely consulted by the industry, most notable being his contribution towards the reliability analysis for Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle. Professor Agarwal was conferred with the Honorary Fellowship by Broadcast Society of India. He was decorated with the Lifetime Achievement Award by the Institution of Electronics and Telecommunication Engineers and also by the Computer Society of India. Sir, we indeed feel honored to have you here with us today in the inaugural session of the Gibbs Talks Season 1. May I please request Professor Agarwal to kindly carry the session forth. Over to you, sir.
Agarwal sir, may please put your video on. Your microphone is still off, sir.
Is it okay now?
Yes, sir. Please. Yeah.
Okay. I'm so happy to be here as a part of this program on required changes in technical education organized by one of our institutions, which was created when I was the Vice Chancellor of IP University, Delhi. I remember, hello?
Yes,
Your
sir.
video has gone off.
Yeah, but it is happening from your side.
No, sir. From your side only.
It says connection is low and.
Okay, so you carry on. Everybody get your voice, sir.
So, I remember the establishment of these institutions under the broad umbrella of Gita Ratan institutions when I was the vice chancellor. And I'm so happy to learn that even after a decade of my relinquished the charge of the vice chancellor, the institutions are doing very great. They are progressing well and they are serving the society in the manner expected of them. So my compliments to all the management formally on this occasion that they are advancing the cause of education, which is so very important to this country and more so to the town of Delhi, which was really lacking. Friends, the program also has been envisaged very judiciously, where it is intended to talk about changes in education in different formats, in different sessions, as a result of COVID-19. So I'm happy to be here this evening, to be with you, to be interacting with the young minds, to see how can we overcome it, how can we go it through. First thing, I hope you will understand that all of you attending this webinar today, for them, this is the highest order of disruption which has happened in their lifetime. I'm sure none of us have ever seen a disruption of this magnitude in our lifetime. And I am pretty hopeful that none of us will see a disruption of this order later in our life. So the why I'm trying to say is disruption is really very great. I mean, if I talk about, I mean, you have all seen how many countries are affected, how many people are affected. You're looking to the news every day. But if I talk about education alone, 1.5 billion students, whether from schools, colleges, or universities, are outside their schools, colleges, or the universities in the whole world. And they have to be taken care of at their respective homes without their any possibility of coming to the school or the college or the university. Now imagine this scenario. In India alone, we have 33 crores students who are sitting at their home doing whatever study is possible at their home. So the scenario is really very largely disruptive, and overnight we were caught in a situation where schools have to be closed, colleges have to be closed, and we have to sort of somehow try to keep the students busy in online education. So this disruption, there have been disruptions in the history. There have been positive disruptions, there have been negative disruptions. When I talk about positive disruptions, for example, people very seriously tell that printing press is a disruption. Before the invention of the printing press, when it was not possible for us to print the books, the students had no other option but to listen to the teacher very attentively in the class. And that was the only method of learning. Thereafter, printing press came. So the students became a little complacent. Well, even if I miss the teacher's word, I can always go back and read the book. Now, it's a good thing, but at the same time, it's a bad thing that the concentration between the teacher and the student reduced. So why I'm trying to tell you this is every disruption in history has a set of positives, a set of negatives. Some disruptions are dominantly negative. Some disruptions are dominantly positive. I just talked about printing press. It's a dominantly positive disruption. Although, as I've told you, there is a negative fallout that the students depend much more on the printed books than the knowledge of the teachers, than the knowledge of the society, than trying to observe the facts, than trying to observe the nature, and then learn. That part has gone down, which is not very desirable. Similarly, we say electricity is a disruption. None of you can probably imagine a world without electricity. But just take yourself just about 70, 80 years ago, we hardly had electricity at very few selected pockets. Even now, you may find some villages which are just very recently connected to electricity in very few locations. And imagine the world without electricity. But that's a disruption. Similarly, if we say smartphone is a disruption. Smartphone, we just didn't have it 15 years ago. And now everybody has it. And the society is completely transformed by smartphone. Now again, look at the pluses and minuses. When a few months before, we were discussing smartphones are a distraction, students should not be allowed to bring it to the schools and the colleges. And I'm sure even your institutions were discouraging bringing smartphone to the classrooms and within the college or the school premises because it's a distraction. And today we feel smartphone is the only savior during this COVID-19 period. So whatever looked bad proves to be good and vice versa at times. This has been the nature of disruptions. How to define a disruption is difficult, but I came across a very good small quote, which I thought I'll read to the young faculty or the students here. It says, what is disruptive technology? It says, when TV came to my house, I forgot how to read books. When the car came to my doorstep, I forgot how to walk. When I got the mobile in my hand, I forgot how to write letters. When computer came to my house, I forgot spellings. When the AC came to my house, I stopped going under the tree for cool breeze. When I stayed in the city, I forgot the smell of mud. By dealing with banks and cards, I forgot the value of money. With the smell of perfume, I forgot the fragrance of fresh flowers. With the coming of fast food, I forgot to cook traditional cuisines. Always running around, I forgot how to stop. And lastly, when I got WhatsApp, I forgot how to talk. So these are some of the examples of disruption. And friends, my reason for telling this is COVID-19 is also a great disruption. And as I said earlier, it's probably the greatest disruption which all of us have seen in our lifetime. Having said that, it is impacting everything. It is impacting political situations. It is impacting health infrastructure like anything. It is impacting economics of the nations so severely. It is impacting social relations. It is impacting transportation problems. And as we are concerned today in this webinar, it is impacting education in a very big way, in a very major way. 3 months before, we would say, all of us practically, that online education is not a good method of education. Many of us believed it. Some of us, like me, were a little moderate, but some of colleagues believed very strongly that online education is no way. It has to be face-to-face education. There are reasons for it, because in this country, online education or the mutant of distant education was handled very badly at many places, and therefore the distance education probably lost respect to itself, and therefore we believe this is no way of education. But now this has come out as a savior, because if we would not have adopted online education, then what were the students doing all this time? What were the teachers possibly doing this time? And we would not have even possibly passed out the batch. Now at least all universities are thinking that they've completed the content for the final semester and we are somehow prepared to conduct the exam. There are various methods again. There are some institutions the world over which have even decided to give the final degree without the final semester exam. They feel, okay, if the student has been here with us for 3 semesters or 7 semesters, why can't we take that assessment as the final assessment, plus the continuous assessment which was there before the lockdown, and give them a final degree. This has been done world over, and India also, some institutions have done it. Some others are still thinking that they can conduct a examination in a month's time by calling students in batches. So we are now prepared that some 20 or some 100 students will get question paper A, and another 100 students in the afternoon will get question paper B, and we are okay with it. Imagine 3 months before, if I had told some institution or some university that you can have two different question papers, they would say, sir, what are you saying? How will the two question papers compare? How will the performance of the two sets of students compare? But now we are okay with it because we believe that is the way to go about. Flexibility has to be built in. A vice chancellor of a very big university from South called me a few days ago. He said, sir, my problem is I can reach about 70% students, can conduct their exam in some form or the other, but my 30% students are in remote areas which are not connected at all. I can't even send them an email. So what do I do? I said, don't let the present 70% suffer for the 30% which are there, and also don't allow 30% to suffer later. So let us conduct exam for 70% now and for 30% after 2 months when the things normalize. So all these flexibilities in education have to be built in. I personally have been talking about flexible education system, but I think COVID has given us an opportunity to bring flexibility into the main curriculum, main part of education. As these Gita Ratan institutions are a part of IP University, you would please recall that IP University still have the system that you can take more credits to study than which are required to pass the exam for the degree. And you have the liberty to drop some credits, to fail in some credits, and still get your degree. So that's the kind of flexibility which was built in IP University more than 20 years ago. Today, every university will have to do that, because when the student is on blended, on online learning, he may say, well, sir, what is the problem if I take this course from MIT Harvard? What is the issue? MIT Harvard professor is prepared to register me, and if I take the course there, what is the problem? Now you, for all possible reasons, cannot say that the standard is not good or the delivery is not acceptable to me. We just can't say that. And therefore, we will have to devise a mechanic, ways and means to incorporate all these changes in our academic system, in our education system, to ensure that the flexibility is there, and still the student is able to get the best out of the present situation. My dear friends, online education is a good method of education, but is certainly not the solution to all problems. As we will be concentrating on technical education during this session, say for example, technical institutions, labs, conduct of labs online, although virtual labs has become a reality, people are doing it, word over, some people are doing even medical education online, but nonetheless, it is still a little difficult thing for us to face, and laboratories is an issue, project is an issue, teamwork is an issue. When we give a project to four students to work together in the lab, that's an issue. So there are issues which are there, and therefore, ideal situation, according to me, after this peak of COVID goes away, when we come to the classroom for face-to-face teaching, will be what I call as blended mode of learning. Because complete face-to-face education will not be possible even after the situation normalizes, because keeping in view the social distancing, you can't have a classroom of 100 or 60 or 70, things like that. You can't have a laboratory where 30 students can work at a time. You can't have an activity room where 30 students can work at a time. And therefore, and no institution can triplicate these facilities in a month's time or 2 months' time. And therefore, you will have to come to a system where the students will come to the institution for a limited number of hours. Instead of 30 hours per week or 32 hours per week, we might have to reduce it to 20 hours per week, or 22 hours per week, 18 hours per week, depending upon subject to subject. And the remaining time, the students will be expected to be engaged online still. So what I see the future of all education, school education, higher education, technical education, all education practically will be a blended mode of education where some part of the curriculum will be delivered in the classroom, in the laboratories, in the actual brick and mortar structure of the institutions, but a major part may be delivered online. Now, how much will be this part will depend from subject to subject. There may be some courses in management, say, for example, which is the organizer of this program. Some courses can be delivered reasonably well online. Some just cannot be. You can't teach derivatives in financial management online easily, but you might be able to see a organizational behavior online. But then you need organizational behavior case studies to be discussed face to face. So my dear teachers and students, you will all have to be prepared for a blended mode of education whereby you might be asked to go to the college or the university 3 days a week, 4 days a week, or depending on half day per day or something like that. Partly you will be in the universities or the colleges or the schools, but partly you will have to be engaging yourself online. It may be by your own teachers. It may be by the courses which are available. In India, for example, when I talk about technical education, NPTEL is a beautiful platform where so many technical courses are available, written by IIT professors and all that. The other platforms could be MOOCs platform, where the under the Swayam platform, we have developed so many courses for education. I also personally see nothing debarring you from taking a course from another university in the country or another university abroad. Because if it has to be online, how can I insist on boundaries of domain? And that probably will be a very beautiful beginning for the education, where the best of the world is available to me to design my degree. You must have all heard about what we call as Industrial Revolution 4.0. We are amidst it, and Industrial Revolution 4.0, the most beautiful part of Industrial Revolution 4.0 is it is integrating cyber physical systems. The physical systems and computer systems will join hands to deliver the results. And even medical systems will become a part of it. It will be very difficult for me to distinguish if there is a computer in which the memory is by DNA strands, is it a medical system or is it a IT system? So the sort of thinning lines between various disciplines will phase out to a good extent, and we will have to be comfortable with the combination of subjects taking shapes into various new domains coming up. Integration of medical and non-medical will be one. Integration of subjects which really appear non-integrable will happen. I'll tell you, future will see to it a degree which is between common to mathematics and music. You will study music and mathematics together. You will study physics and philosophy together. It's not physics and electronics. It's not mathematics and computer science. It will be physics and philosophy, mathematics and music. Stanford University, which is one of the best universities in the world, 2 years ago, started two five-year programs. One is computer science and English. And second is computer science and music. Well, I am a student of computer science, but to envisage that 10 years down the line, there will be requirement of professionals which would be knowing computer science and music, or there will be requirement of professionals which would be knowing computer science and English is a vision which they have translated. And probably many such things we'll have to pick up, because when we are going to computers, which will depend so much on language processing, emotions processing. I was going through the speech of a eminent person abroad, and he starts with the sentence, "The computers are dead." Now, it was very difficult to really appreciate that the computers are dead when we are so much dependent on the computers. And the rate of change of computers is terrific. As a matter of fact, even the PC is on way out. From 2015, we are selling more Kindles, more notebooks than PCs. So that's the change. But when he says computers are dead, and at the end of his 30 minutes talk, he says, "Long live the computers." When I went to the details, what he meant was that the computers as they are seen today, having a keyboard, having a mouse, will be dead. The computers tomorrow will be taking inputs from your voice. You will speak to the computer. They will take inputs from all online data put together. They will take inputs from your emotions. Your picture will translate into many data into the computer. And computers will read what is your mind and which movie will you like to see today. That will be their decision and it will be best decision for you. So the computers will completely change. I'm saying this because computer is my subject. I'm more involved in this, but this is going to happen in almost all fields of knowledge. And disruptive scenarios give us this picture faster than normally we have. For example, let's look to the design of ventilators post-COVID-19. Well, ventilators were there always in our hospitals, charges exorbitant and everything. But COVID-19 made the ventilators so essential, so necessary, that today we have designed ventilators in India by Indian students and teachers in Indian institutions, and a ventilator of the size of a toaster in the kitchen, which can be used at home by the patient or his attendants themselves without going to the hospital. Now that's a discovery which comes out of a disruptive scenario. We have, say, talking about management scenario, we were able to convert distilleries into sanitizer factories within 3 days. We were able to convert sugar factories into sanitizer factories within 4 days. That is the rate of adaptation which a situation like this forces on us, and we have to keep on encashing that. Well, friends, my suggestion to all my younger colleagues would be, the next generation belongs to creativity and innovation, and not so much to the conformance. Syllabus will have a meaning. Examination question paper will have to be set out of the syllabus. But these boundaries of knowledge confinement will have much less meaning. So try to see how much you can keep it open. Well, I understand you are an affiliated institutions, so therefore the complete control is not with you for the syllabus, for the examination organization, and so on and so forth. But nonetheless, whatever you can do outside the syllabus, outside the classroom, group activity, let's do all these things, start right away in the good earnest. Second point, which I thought I'll touch briefly, is like any real life problem, COVID also could not be seen as a single discipline problem. If the world would have seen COVID as a medical problem only, or even in India, if we would have seen COVID only as a medical problem, we would have made a mess of it. And wherever we made a mistake, we did make a mess of it to some extent. But COVID is a medical problem, but along with it, you have to handle it economically, you have to handle it politically, you have to handle it socially, you have to handle it on transportation mechanism, you have to handle it on labor mechanism, and so on and so forth. So all real life problems do require the knowledge of several subjects to be able to solve the problem. So my request and advice to all my young friends in these days of my webinars to them is, please concentrate on your own subject, but at the same time, keep yourself open to side subjects, with the main dish, learn to enjoy quite a few side dishes, because that will give you a nice meal. I mean, I hope you will agree with me, only with a good main dish is not that nice a meal. If you have three good side dishes along with it, it becomes a better meal. Same analogy, you will have to adopt, learn many subjects. And an author has written a beautiful book which says, tomorrow you will have to have a T-shaped personality. And from T-shaped personality, the author means you will have to have depth of knowledge in a subject, but at the same time, you have to have breadth of knowledge in several subjects. If you have only depth, you will not be successful. If you have only breadth, you will not be successful. So please make sure this is a mantra of your life. I have to be very thorough in my subject, but at the same time, I cannot plead ignorant of other subjects. I will have to pick them up, learn to apply them, and see how can we put these things together and take it further. Friends, finally, I thought I'll discuss with you that flexibility at every level, we will have to make sure that our institutions have more flexibility. Institutions will have to make sure our teachers have more flexibility. Teacher empowerment will be a must for the future, because unless you empower the teachers, online education and all that will have very little to do. Syllabus as defined cannot be communicated in the set mechanism. Stephen Hawking, you must have all heard, the greatest, one of the greatest physicists of the times. He was asked, I think a few months before his death, they were asked that, Sir Hawking, your century belonged to physics. Will the next century belong to biology, we feel? Professor Hawking said, I really don't know which subject will it belong to, but it will belong to complexity. You will have so much complex systems to handle that you cannot even define the problem by a single subject. You might have to apply several subjects to solve a complex problem. But let me also assure you, some of the very complex problems have very simple solutions. And we should be open to complex problems, but keep a mind of solving. It could be a very simple solution. Don't be afraid of complexity, because that is where you will have to live with. You cannot also design inefficiency into the systems. I read a case study where some scientist from abroad was visiting India, and the road was being dug with the help of shovels. And he asked his counterpart, he said, when there are so many bulldozers to dig the roads, why are you still using shovels? It's a very inefficient system. And our people replied, sir, we are a labor-intensive country. Therefore, we prefer to use shovels than big machines. He said, well, that's not the way. If you are a labor-intensive country, think of jobs which can be done by the labor or retrained labor. But, and if you are only worried about inefficient systems, then why use shovels? You use spoons and dig the earth if you want inefficiency. So the point is, let's make sure that we will be efficient, we'll be flexible, we'll be interdisciplinary, we'll be open to new ideas, and we will keep our eyes and ears open because we do not know what next. So with these words, I think I'll close my initial remarks today and take up some questions whenever the opportunity arises. And I take you back to the studio with Kavya. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for enlightening all of us with your humble words of wisdom. Thank you so much. And I'm really sure that all the attendees must have been inspired and enjoyed this session a lot. Now, to begin with the question and answer session, I would like to inform you all that we have received more than 1,000 questions as submitted by different stakeholders at the time of their registration. And I also believe that all the attendees would love to get their queries answered by Sir. However, due to paucity of time, we are placing only the best questions before Professor Agarwal to clarify the maximum area of coverage. So with your kind permission, Sir, shall we begin?
Sure, sure.
Thank you, Sir. So the first question that has been put forward is by Dr. Rajesh S. Pingavil, Professor at Rajdhani Business School, Trivandrum, Kerala. So the question that he has put forth is, what will be the new evaluation process?
Dr. Rajesh, I believe there will be no single evaluation process. We will have to apply several evaluation processes at the same time. This mindset that every subject must be examined by a 3 hours theory question paper will, I think, have to go. It may be still suitable for some subjects, but mostly not. And so we might have to evaluate by examination, theory examination. We might have to evaluate by group evaluation. Three teachers talk to 10 students and evaluate them. That could be a method of examination. Our evaluation could be by a case study. Our evaluation could be by a report. I mean, people have very wild ideas. I saw a foreign university abroad. They gave a problem. Can I tomorrow have an elevator which takes me to the moon? I mean, you know, there's a probing thing, and let the students write essays on that. So evaluation will be a mixed tool of toolbox, and we will use a set of tools for each subject, depending on the nature of the subject. That will be an ideal evaluation process, according to me. Our mindset that every subject has to be evaluated in this particular fashion will have to go.
Thank you, sir. That was quite a practical answer. So the next question has been put forth by Dr. Ashutosh Bajpai, who's a faculty at Sri Ram Murthy Smarak International Business School, Lucknow. The question that he seeks to ask is, what are your views on COVID-19 recovery and planning from a student's perspective?
Dr. Ashutosh, I fully agree with your statement. And I have always believed that student perspective into education is a must. As a matter of fact, entire birth of my university, IP University, was based on student perspectives. Because unless we see the education from the point of view of student, we are not serving the purpose of the society. Students of this country have been too good to allow us to go by our perspectives. We basically decided to teach what we learned and what we know, but that has to change. Our student perception has to be translated into their knowledge requirement, and that has to be translated into what you call a syllabus or curriculum or whatever. So student perspective will not only be included, will be very highly emphasized and should be emphasized. This is my take on this. Next.
Thank you, sir. Moving forth with the next question. The next question is by Ms. Ahalya, research scholar, IIT Delhi. The question is, how can we revamp technical education so as to make it more accessible to students living in remote areas who lack even the necessary infrastructure facilities?
Ahalya, this is an issue. I agree. There are some areas still in the country where the infrastructure facilities are lacking, and to take online education to those students is a challenge. And I covered it in my initial remarks also. So maybe we will have to bear with this situation for a few more months or so. Country is progressing on broadband connectivity in a very speedy fashion. I mean, the rate of speed is terrific. And I'm very sure very soon we will be able to cover broadband, take broadband connection to every remote corner of this country. But till that time, yes, it's an issue and we'll have to live with it. We'll have to find some solutions that the students from remote areas, can they physically come to a nearby city where there's a connection, or so on and so forth. For some months, we'll have to bear with it.
Thank you, sir. The next question has been put forth by Professor K. Jayashankar, principal, Mahatma Gandhi Institute of Technology. The question that he seeks to ask is there any possibility of exchanging the extending the accreditation validity?
Well, Professor Jayashankar, let me tell you, we have already decided that whatever accreditations were valid till 30th June 2020 will have the possibility of a 1 year extension. We will ask you some basic data, and on the basis of that basic data, we'll extend your accreditation by 1 year on the payment of a nominal fee, and thereafter we put you into the normal process. So 1 year extension will be quite feasible, subject to certain basic parameters for all institutions. That's the decision already taken by me.
Thank you, sir. Moving forward, the next question, which has been put forth by Ms. Kamal, who's a research scholar at Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University, Delhi. The question is, technical structure of our country for taking online classes is not highly strong. We still need to depend on Zoom, Cisco meetings, Google Meet, etc. for our regular classes. So how can we move forward to make India's own strong interface for e-learning?
Well, Kamana, first of all, I really do not believe there should be anything against a foreign technology as long as it serves our purpose. But at the same time, I do agree that we should be able to have our own platforms for everything, because that helps us to be more Atmanirbhar, if I use the word. And I'm happy that quite a bit of effort is going on in this direction, and some platforms are already in the offing to replace Zoom or Cisco or Google Meet, etc. But yes, much more work has to be done. The foreign countries started working on this much earlier, because online method of working or working from home was a concept in advanced countries even before COVID. I mean, I know many countries or many workers in the USA, for example, were asked to come to the office only 2 days a week or 3 days a week and work for the remaining days at home, because they believe that can be equally effective done and that can save office space and so on and so forth. But because the necessity was there with them, therefore they developed these things earlier. Now necessity has come to us, and I'll call upon research scholars like you to work in this direction and develop our own interfaces, which are better than the interfaces abroad and more cost effective. And I'm very sure it will be done very soon.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Mr. Feroz Ahmed, faculty from CCS University, Meerut. The question is, how can we improve the technical knowledge of teachers or other people if they do not know anything about computer usage or technology?
Well, Feroz, I would strongly say it is high time that to use computers must be learned. It will be very difficult to conceive a situation where somebody doesn't know how to use computer or technology. And let me tell you honestly, as a professor of computer science, learning to use computers is not at all difficult. Learning to design computers is difficult. Learning to research on computers is difficult. But computers are so user-friendly. As a matter of fact, one of the basic principles of computer science, right from beginning of computer science, has been that put in more effort at the research level, put in more effort at the prototype level, but make it very easy for the users. I'll tell you, say for example, to use a smartphone, what do you need to know? Nothing, practically. And therefore, to use computers is something very simple. And I remember having delivered a lecture some 35 years ago that CS only requires CS. And I meant computer science requires only common sense. So if you have common sense, you will learn how to use computers. And my request, advice, suggestion would be, please go ahead and learn it and make your pupil teachers, I think you meant that, pupil teachers also to do that, because school education without computer also will be impossible. And if still necessary, I think some universities can conduct some awareness programs for the teachers or the pupil teachers to learn computers, but this cannot be wished away. This has to be taken headstrong. Yeah.
Well explained, sir. Thank you. Moving forward with the next question. The next question is from DVS S. Shiv Sharma, who's a faculty at NIT Warangal. The question that he seeks to ask is, faculty with qualifications and research really do not have the understanding of how a learner learns. So is it not essential to have something like Indian Teacher Service, like IAS or IRS, to help teachers undergo training in the teaching learning process, especially in engineering education, before commencement of their teaching profession?
Well, there are two parts to this question. One is engineering teachers, I agree, do not have any formal exposure to teaching learning process, by and large. And this is a shortcoming of the system. Some suggestions which have come, and I myself have given some suggestions. One is those people who want to become teachers while doing their master's degree, M.Tech degree, let one semester be on the teaching learning processes. So if you make up your mind that after M.Tech, instead of going to the industry, you want to come to teaching profession, one semester can be given for teaching learning process. That is one possibility which is being thought of. Second is AICT has designed modules for teaching learning process to be teachers to be become more comfortable. I think we have to promote that much better, much stronger. And thirdly, your suggestion for a teacher service, let me tell you, I have given this suggestion formally also. I prepared a report on behalf of Vivekananda International Foundation for Science and Technology Education. And one of my recommendations is there should be a service like Indian Education Service on the lines of IAS and IRS, so that we have teaching as a cadre. When will this recommendation be accepted, if at all? I can't say, but your point is valid. There must be some exposure to teaching learning to the engineering teachers. Well said. Next.
Thank you, sir. Sir, moving forth with the next question, which has been put forth by Dr. Shrikant Kulkarni, faculty, Vishwakarma Institute of Technology, Pune. The question is, foreign collaboration or collaborative activities have gone down to zero. So whether National Board of Accreditation will ease this criterion in the accreditation process or not?
Well, Dr. Kulkarni, first of all, I do not agree that foreign collaboration or collaborative activities have gone down to zero. What has gone down to zero is foreign people are not able to come to India. We are not able to go abroad. That has gone down to zero. But I see the webinars and all that from all universities, and I hope you, if you analyze, you are getting many, many, much more speakers today on your webinars from abroad than you were ever able to have. I think universities which used to have maybe 10 speakers from abroad in a year are now having 10 speakers from abroad every month. That is the kind of increase in activity as far as foreign knowledge providers are concerned. So I don't agree that the activities have gone to zero. Yes, a part of the activity where visits were really necessary has gone down to zero. So I do not think it will impact and be a scorecard, because we don't ask for specific activities, we ask for total collaboration. But nonetheless, if it is found that it is affecting, we will go into this reality and make the necessary changes wherever needed.
Thank you so much, sir. So the next question is really highly demanded one. A lot many participants have put forth these questions while their registration process. So the question is, will online teaching replace the real classroom teaching?
Well, I have given this answer already in my talk. My answer is no. Online teaching will not replace the real classroom teaching, but online teaching will certainly supplement the real classroom teaching and will be required as a supplement necessarily. So you can't wish online teaching away, but online teaching will completely replace the real classroom teaching. I don't feel it will happen, and I don't see it is happening in near future. And that is why I say the future belongs to a blended mode of learning, where part will be online, part will be face to face. So complete online replacement under the circumstances where we are in a situation that we can't go to the school or the college. It's okay. I mean, you know, there are some emergency solutions which you have to accept. If the traffic is so much, you obviously go slow. So that's possible. But that does not mean going slow is a method of life. So online teaching at the moment, yes, very welcome, very desirable, very feasible. But for a long run, no, it will have to be made a substitutional teaching to whatever extent possible. And again, I repeat, it will vary from subject to subject. It will vary from location to location. For example, where there is no broadband, there will be no replacement at all. But where, so it will be locational dependent, it will be teacher dependent, it will be university dependent, it will be subject dependent. And I also go to the extent that in the same class, if you have a class of 100 students, if 30 students say, sir, we are comfortable only with face-to-face, and the remaining 70 say, okay, we are comfortable with both. You might have to design your teaching for 70% in a different manner, for 30% in a different manner, and all this will have to be acceptable to the universities tomorrow.
Indeed, true, yes. Sir. Thank you. Moving forward with the next question, which has been put forward by Ms. Mary Cherian, faculty at Kumar Guru College of Technology. So the question is, for MBA, corporate projects are a necessary part of experiential learning. Whatever online internships one does, it can never replace the learning that an actual physical internship or object gives. Your kind comments, please.
Well, Ms. Mary, this is an observation which you are giving, not a question, and I agree with it. The internship or the experiential learning, to replace it by an online tool may not be very easy, may not be very desirable, may not be feasible in every case. You probably have to learn to have a mindset where maybe to begin with, you can have 25% projects online. There are some very good projects which can be done online. Say for example, data collection, data capturing online, your management students have been running about physically over buses and bikes and cars to collect the data. That part can be very easily done online. So some part of it can be done online, some projects can be done online, but not everything, I agree. And I believe we should again keep our mind open that some students may do it online, some students may do it offline. Under the circumstances, I will have to accept online for everybody for this semester, but from future onwards, let it be flexible so that I am prepared for a next disruption if unfortunately it comes. So we keep flexibility, and that is my take on this.
Thank you so much for directing us, sir. So due to paucity of time, it's not possible for us to take more questions. However, this one would be the last one. So the last question has been raised by Mr. Muralidhar Kulkarni, NIT Suratkal. The question is, should research and teaching be given importance equally?
Professor Kulkarni, I feel equal word is a little difficult to define. But yes, research and teaching both have to be considered important for a teaching institution for the reason which I explained. Teaching, according to me, is the main function of a teaching institution. I, for one, have never really very strongly believed a connection between a research degree and a teacher. But the attribute of doing research, the way of doing research, where you are inquisitive, where you try to challenge the present hypothesis, where you try to search for new solutions, where you try to optimize the solution, where you try to communicate with the peers in the world, all these are attributes which are helpful to all professionals, and therefore every teacher must know that. So I believe every teacher must be engaged in research, whether he really is able to publish papers or get a patent or does an industrial research or just does research for the sake of teaching, they are all acceptable to me if they can be measured nicely. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. We come to an end of question and answer session. Thank you, sir, once again for clearing all our doubts in such a detailed way. Now we've come to the end of today's session. Indeed, I feel blessed to hear Professor Agarwal on the topic, and I'm sure that every attendee must have got immense information. So we will eagerly wait for all those changes as you explained before us to see our country at the parallel level of the educational standard of the globe. Thank you so much, sir, once again for graciously accepting our invitation and being here with us. Once again extend my sincere reverence on behalf of Geeta Ratan International Business School. I'm also thankful to all the attendees for putting up through your provoking questions in the episode to make it even more vibrant. Thank you all for your precious time. Thank you, sir. And I humbly request you all. Thank you, sir. And I humbly request you all to kindly join us in the second episode of Gibbs Talks Season 1 on the next Sunday, which falls on June 21st, 2020, at the same time, 6 p.m. sharp. And the session would be chaired by Padma Shri Professor Dr. Mahesh Verma, Vice Chancellor Guru Gobind Singh, Indraprastha University, Delhi, on the sub-theme, Strength Within, Success Throughout. Thank you so much for your time, everyone. See you all in the next episode of Gibbs Talks Season 1. Till then, good night, take care, stay home and stay safe.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you all organizers.
Thank you so much, sir.